It's a Sharknado! It's the last Sharknado!
Sharks! Hey, get out of the water! Sharks! They're coming in! Shark! 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 Shark!
Go, 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 go! Run away from the Sharknado! It's your greatest fo-fo-fo! Don't wanna get eaten by Sharknado!
They took my grandfather. So I really hate sharks.
Welcome to the Film Thread Podcast. I am Chris Gore, rolling solo on this episode of the podcast, where I'm about to interview Anthony C. Ferrante. Anthony is the director of, well, all six of the Sharknado movies. A lot of people don't know that he also directed a horror film, a ghost film called Boo, which you might actually want to check out. But Sharknado is a phenomenon. I don't think that's an understatement. You know, whether you love the movie or hate it, whether you get its sense of humor, whether you understand it, it's certainly something that everyone would agree is a total phenomenon, just based on I think social media kind of created the monster that is Sharknado. When the first one actually came out back in, 2013, the first Sharknado came out, there was all this hype on Twitter about it. So many people talking about it. It really was something that I think everyone bought into its ridiculousness, and then it actually lived up to the hype or the non-hype, actually. If you think about it, there really wasn't a lot of promotion on this film, other than the fact that it had a ridiculous title that everybody just bought into. And then I think the reason for me that the Sharknado films work is the utter seriousness of everyone in the film. They just buy into the fact that, like, yes, there are Sharknados. Yes, they are scary and they're bloody and gory. It kind of reminds me of, well, the tone of the old 1966 Adam West Batman TV series. You know, within the world, people are completely deadly serious about all the events that are occurring, but all of the events occurring are utterly ridiculous. So I'm really excited to talk to Anthony Ferrante, who has, I've known Anthony like 20 years now from, old Film Threat days. And he wrote for Sci-Fi Universe and, began his career as a journalist and segued into writing scripts and then making films. So I love it when someone that I have known for that long has all kinds of success. Although what level of success? Everyone that's sort of in that situation, you might think, hey, they're successful, but maybe in their minds, they don't think that they're successful. Well, we'll get into a lot of that talking to Anthony. A couple other things I want to let you guys know that we will be at Dragon Con. That's right. Well, I will be at Dragon Con, and then some other members of Film Threat will also be at Dragon Con. Bradley Gibson, Bobby Lapeer, Patty Hawkins. We're going to be doing all sorts of panels. You know, I don't want to get into what they are. Just follow on social media at Film Thread or at that Chris Gore. And you'll see on Friday, August 31st, a whole slew of podcasts, including a second debate, a second Last Jedi debate. And in addition, the Film Thread podcast on Saturday, September 1st. So follow on social media or check out Facebook to get the info on that. Also, maybe you're actually not just listening to this in your ears, you're actually watching this on YouTube. Yes, that's right. Film Threat has a YouTube channel. So if you just, just go to youtube.com/C/FilmThreat or just look up Film Threat on YouTube. Please subscribe to our channel. You can now listen to the Film Threat podcast on YouTube. We're also going to be sharing some clips, some exciting exclusive clips That I don't even want, you know what? You're just going to have to discover it. Just go to the Film Threat YouTube channel. Please subscribe to it. Just doing those simple things, really help support us. And we're going to be doing some more exciting things on YouTube, not just the podcast, but original content. And you can see, the debuts of a lot of indie trailers. I'm really excited to, present and debut exclusive trailers on our YouTube channel. All right. So let's talk to Anthony C. Ferrante about The Last Sharknado. Yeah, Film Threat is back. It's back. It's been back. But yeah, okay. So we're at the, this is the Magical Threads recording studio, which basically is like in the parlor, this bar. Mm-hmm. So they let us record here. So we just, yeah. It's, this. Yeah, there you go. So, okay. So
we're official.
We're official. Yes, this is recorded. So, welcome to the podcast, Anthony C. Ferrante.
Yeah, it's an honor. It's pretty cool. It's kind of full circle here.
Yeah, no, it is full circle. It's just fun to see, like, first of all your success with the Sharknado films. I remember when you told me about the first one, which I couldn't believe. I ran into someone telling me about it, like, maybe 6 months before, just the basic plot of it, of the original Sharknado.
Yeah.
And I said, okay, this is stupid, ridiculous, terrible. I can't wait to see it. Isn't that most of people's, I mean, most people, that's how they react when they first heard of Sharknado.
Yeah, well, the thing that when the idea originally came up, it was Jacob Hare and I as an occasional writing partner, and usually was pitching a lot of, you know, horror films to sci-fi. So, you know, usually the you go in with... through one of the companies that do their, you know, there's like five or six of these low budget companies that deal with them for those things. So you come up with like five or six ideas and then they go, okay, we like that one. And sometimes they go, we want a leprechaun movie. Come up with five different paragraph things and you try to figure it out. And so I was known as the horror guy, you know, the suspense, the monsters, but not the digital effects, you know, gigantic, crazy disaster films. And so I talked to Jacob, let's just come up with two of the most ridiculous ideas. And Lava Birds was one of them. And then Birds That Spew Lava. And then Jake said, Sharknado. And we loved the name from the beginning. And we kept going, we got to do something with this. And every time we told somebody the title, they just fell in love with it. So from the beginning, we knew that I loved the title. And I thought there was something there. I think it was pitched twice and nothing happened. And then I wrote a reference to a Sharknado in a Leprechaun script I was writing for sci-fi. And they go, now we must make this movie. So that's how it happened. And then, you know, again, I wasn't the first person they would think of for this kind of thing. So they were talking to Asylum. Asylum was developing something called Sharkstorm. And they go, you're going to call it Sharknado. And then I was working for the Asylum going, that's our movie. And then they fought to have me on the film, and that's how it all happened.
Well, I mean, you say that's how it all happened. Like, it like was an overnight thing. Like, and then like you were bitten by a radioactive Sharknado. But that's not what happened. I mean, we should back up a little bit because you made films before Sharknado.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And,
yeah.
You have a background as a film journalist. Wait, you wrote stuff for Film Threat.
Yep.
Way back in the print days.
Yep.
Yeah. No, I remember you like hanging out at the offices.
No, but the thing is, everything I've ever done is always tied into specifically what I wanted to do. Because when I was in sixth grade, I knew I wanted to make movies. I just didn't know how. So the easiest thing, being in a small town in Northern California, was I'll just write about movies. And by doing that, that kind of helped because I started understanding film a lot more. And then through stupidity of my own part of just being bold and ballsy, going to the studios and going, give me interviews. And they would give me interviews. And then I would sell them to the local newspaper. And so that's kind of... So everything was about learning about, you know, talking to my idols and learning that way. And then writing scripts and trying to do short films. When I was in high school, the community college started a film class, and I was able to kind of finagle my way into a college course class when I was in high school, and that kind of worked out as well. So that was kind of, once I got access to a camera and editing and stuff like that, I was off to the races. So it's always been a concurrent thing of, you know, always writing and directing shorts, and then, you know, do the journalism, and then finally the movies took full you know, took over. You know, when I moved here to Los Angeles, I worked as a special makeup effects supervisor. And that was a fluke because I had done effects in one of my shorts and I was a PA and they go, do you want to help manage makeup effects? It's like, sure. Because I knew all the effects guys. And I started working with Brian Usna. And Brian Usna would have me involved in, you know, the pre-production. And so I would watch the development and I would come up with ideas for the effects things. And then he let me started doing second unit. So it's just like, it's all kind of leads up to.
Well, it's interesting because I think it was Rod Lurie I had a conversation with talking about journalism. And, you know, a lot of people in journalism, you know, let's say they're music critics, but they don't think that they can actually go and be musicians. Or let's say you cover sports, but you don't think you can actually go and play quarterback for the Detroit Lions, you know. But in film journalism, you actually can crossover. You can be writing about film, talking about film, discussing film, and then suddenly you're making films, right? That kind of crossover is actually more common, say, than other types of journalism, right?
So, yeah, well, I think it's because you've analyzed film enough, and you know, when you've written so many reviews and interviewed so many people,
right?
But again, part of what I was doing is I was absorbing everything because that's what I wanted to do. When I would do an interview with Carpenter or Cronenberg on my idols, I mean, I would be talking to them about the obvious stuff, but then I would be digging into other things of why did you do this and why did you do that? And I have some really great interviews with these guys before they got, you know, before they got super, not saying super jaded, but before they were kind of over it. Before Cronenberg, you know, was like, yeah, I'm going to do this stuff that has nothing to do with horror. He was, you know, I mean, the Crash interview we did with him was probably one of the best interviews I've ever done.
Yeah, it was a great
interview. I think I interviewed him 3 times for that story.
Yeah.
So it's just kind of taking from that stuff and you know, and kind of learning what you want to do. I like a lot of my shorts were horror. Mm-hmm. And then there were some that were kind of comedy, which were just weird, kind of off the cuff, strange things. And then I did Sharknado, which kind of combined both of those things. I always think it's weird. I always tell people that the strangest thing is like, you know, I was the weird kid in high school, like, oh, he likes movies. And then the strangest thing that I did ended up being the most mainstream success I've ever had.
Well, yeah, I mean, it is like, it really, you put your heart and soul into it. I mean, you can't just say that it's like this cheesy, you know, one-off thing or whatnot. Like, all your film knowledge and everything, if you look at the Sharknado movies, there's far more, we're talking last night at the premiere.
Yeah.
You know, there's heart, there's all kinds of references, most of which I get, but there are definitely tons of references to things.
Yeah.
And there's also a just sense of like, I feel like you know what it is.
Well, yeah, the thing is that there's a lot of movies out there that are direct, that they do this stuff, but they're direct parodies. They're not their own movie. They're just an assemblage of, we're just going to do this gag. Like the scary movie type things, the epic movies, those things. Like, they're just stringing together set pieces from other films and maybe adding a joke or two.
Yeah, they're like sketches.
They're sketches, yeah. And the thing is, we're still trying to tell a story. And at the thing I learned from John Sayles, you know, with Piranha and Alligator and all the stuff that he did in Howling, is make it about something. And, you know, if it's about something, even if it's underlying, then there's a heart. And in this case, I mean, the whole duration of the Sharknado is they're about family. Strip everything away, it's about family. And
I wonder if Thunder Levin agrees with that, because I will say, having had conversations with Thunder, which that's a whole other conversation unto itself, Thunder is a character. First of all, his name is Thunder. Thunder Levin, the screenwriter of the first 4 Sharknados.
Yeah.
I've gotten to these discussions with him. He says, without any, not flinching, that the Sharknado films are about global climate change, and it is a wake-up call for global climate change. And he says this in all seriousness, and he never, so can I ask, is he doing a bit? Because every time I talk to him, he's one of the most serious guys I've ever spoken to in the film industry, and he's got to be kidding, right? Is he fucking with me?
Look, Thunder's Thunder. Thunder has very specific ideas about these movies, and then, you know, I have very specific ideas about these movies, and you know, we had a great relationship on the 4 films, but generally, a lot of the weirder stuff and sort of my stripping out like any commentary was on my side, where no, we're not doing that. I never wanted the villain to be explained. That was the number one thing about that first film. And you hear on the TV, you know, oh, maybe it's global warming, and you have the shark finning boat, which we added like because I wanted to have a teaser that had some, you know, because we had, I think it was one line in the script of a boat's attacking. No, we're turning this into a meal. But we never explained why Sharknadoes exist. Now, if you go back through all six movies, you can keep saying, oh, yeah, but in number four, it's like, no. Number five, they've existed since prehistoric. Nope. If you look at what we did, especially in five, I was okay with explaining that they've been around forever, but I knew that the reason they've been around forever is because in that film, Gil went back in time and was leaving clues for his dad. There's no retconning from five to six. If you look at the prehistoric paintings on the wall, it's signed Gil. Mm-hmm. Because I wanted it to be the snake eating the tail. And even in this movie where you go, oh, maybe it's April's fault, or maybe it's this. No. Sharknado is a natural disaster. It's not sharks. It's not tornadoes. That's why they can go into space. That's why they can take them down. It's Sharknado is the villain. And the thing from the second movie on was the Sharknado can do whatever we tells it to because it's our villain.
Right.
And the more that you know about it, the less power it has. And that's why I always just said, it's just a force of nature. And that's kind of been the driving narrative thrust.
Doesn't that kind of ruin things when you take out the mystery? Like when we found, you know, when you find, I almost think that like finding out Darth Vader's backstory was really sort of stripped out the mystery. Or even like now we're supposed to get a Boba Fett movie. Like, do we really want to demystify? I mean,
so the Solo movie, which I liked a lot, uh-huh. except that there were a couple things in there. Is like, really, does he have to be called Solo because
he's traveling solo?
Yeah, that was like one of those things. Like, you didn't need to do that,
right?
Yeah, there were a couple things they didn't need to do, but they did a lot of things right despite all the problems with that film with the behind the scenes stuff that they had. But yeah, it's look it, the. I think that the Sharknado movies would not have been a success if it wasn't for the fact that another rule we had in these movies, and it was, again, something I laid down from the beginning, no military scientists or doctors solving problems. Now, we've had doctors, the military pops up in three, but to help Finn, but they're, like, while the military, like I always said, like in the first movie, while the military is trying to figure out what the hell to do, and they have scientists and everybody's going, oh, we gotta stop the Sharknado. It's destroying everything. What are we gonna do? Meanwhile, we're telling the story about like what's happening on the Santa Monica Pier with these guys that don't know what the hell's going on, and are going, well, I gotta save my family. Let's throw bombs in the tornado. You know, it's like the B, like they're the B, they're like the D story in a normal studio big budget action movie, and that's I think why you liked it, because there are these people that don't know what's going on, and they're just trying to save themselves and their family.
Right.
And you know, the Sharknado movies get a lot of flack for a lot of things. There's people that hate watch. I get it. But, you know, and you know, sometimes there's rough around the edges. You know, sometimes we get crapped on for the visual effects and stuff. But, you know, we do these movies in 5 months, 6 months. I think part of the charm is that, there are rough things around the edges, but there's a sincerity in what we're doing.
That totally comes across, and I think it comes across mostly from Ian Ziering's character. Mostly from Finn Shepard. I mean, his character is so dead serious. I mean, I almost think he's kind of channeling a little bit of Jason Statham, you know, in terms of his, you know, intensity in terms of an action star. I mean, it's this whole, we have to do this. When he gives like that epic speech in two, standing on the cab, right?
Yeah.
Like, I mean, with the chainsaw, and then of course slices a shark. There are effects that obviously there are effects that you spend a lot of time on. And there are ones where it's just like, you got to cut away quick from that one, right?
Well, think about it. The visual effects team, which Glenn Campbell was our supervisor on 5 and 6. Glenn had 5 weeks to do 1,200 visual effects shots, and there's some pretty damn amazing visual effects shots in these movies. And then in some cases, some things we just didn't have time. They're first takes on things, so you know we try to basically accept that when we go into this, we're making the best movie we can with the tools we're given. We have 18 days to make a studio movie. We're making a studio movie in 18 days. We start shooting in February. We deliver in July. In this case, we delivered 3 days before it aired. It's insane.
And how does Sci-Fi Channel love that? They're just like 3 days before, they like on pins and needles, like concerned.
Yeah, no, but look, we care that we care about what's going to air. I mean, the version that the Friday before that we had to deliver just to get promo master so they can start working on trailers and stuff. You know, we were like, this is not going to air, but it was what it was. But then by the time we got to Wednesday, it's like night and day, you know, it was mixed, mm-hmm. We had all the fine, we were dropping in visual effects shots for that promo master. And in some cases, if something wasn't done, we were taking one shot and duplicating it just so it narratively it worked for that purpose. Mm-hmm. So, they're hard movies to do, but the thing is we're not making, here's the thing is a lot of people, when they have these budgets, They go, we can't do it. Let's do this. Like I'll give an. I was working on a film as a writer, and I wrote a scene on a plane. And I go, we can't afford the plane. Make it a boat. I'm like, yeah, but you just get this at Air Hollywood. No, make it a boat. Okay, great. I wrote it for a boat. We can't afford a boat. It needs to be a car. It's like, okay, all right, it's fine. I'll make it a car. I kept waiting for them to go, you know, we can't afford a car. It needs to be a bicycle. But the thing is, when I saw the finished movie, that car was not even a moving vehicle. It was a stationary vehicle. So the big action sequence at the end was a stationary vehicle. And I'm not disparaging what it is. It's just in their heads, oh, we can't do that. One of the things Robbie Rist, who I've done a lot of the songs for in the movies, and who is in the first film and the sixth film.
Did he do the title track?
Yeah, we rewrote that.
Okay. Oh my God, the title track is great.
On the new movie, it's completely rearranged. Yeah.
But it seems like they're different arrangements because there's six of the six. It's the same song, but like
we change it every time. That's what
I thought, because there's like a different lines in each.
The lyrics are the same. Second, but it, with parts of the, like the song's like a 2 minute song, but we only have 1 minute for credit. So we kind of pick and cherry pick, but. Like the song appeared in the end titles in the first one, and then the same version appeared in 2 and 3 in the main titles is the same. We did a New York version for 2 that played somewhere else in the movie. And in 4, we remixed it. And in 5, we did a mashup of that and a rock opera we did called Sharknado Rhapsody. And then this one, we did a Saturday morning cartoon.
Well, no, I love it. It's, I mean, if you learned anything from David Cronenberg, it's have a great title sequence because I actually, having interviewed Cronenberg myself, I asked him about his title sequences and he says he likes to have a good title sequence at the end to get the audience to just be quiet and sit down and get their popcorn going and just sort of settle in. But yeah, the title sequences for all the Sharknado movies they're great. There's effort put into it. There's effort put into places where it's not normally put in, say for a film of that scale. I guess that's my point.
And that's the thing is that there's just Robbie and I probably do 4 to 6 songs per movie because they're mm-hmm. part of the tone of the film. The animation thing, it's something, the music and the animation are things that are separate from the craziness of regular production. Right. You know, it's just Rob and I, and if they use the songs, they don't use them, it doesn't matter. So we have free reign to kind of go, okay, I want to do this, I want to do that. And then if it fits in and it's approved, most of the time it has, then we've been good. The animation thing, I've hired outside animators and I've just worked with them. Well, the second movie we did, the taking things from New York and then,
yeah, that was cool. Titling.
And when we went back to do a couple like little inserts and pickups in New York, I rode around on a bike, one of the New York bikes with our 7D, and I took plate shots for that title sequence.
And that's how that title sequence came about.
Yeah, so I went and grabbed things that I knew for the title sequence, and then I had an animator do that thing. And then on the third one, we hired Tim Hopkins to do the animation on that. It was quick. But we would come up with ideas, and then he would put it together. But there's no, like they don't normally, most of the title sequences for silent movies are get some pretty aerial shots, and that makes the movie look cute and looks great.
Right.
So that's what they normally do. But in this one, I wanted to just, let's give an extra bonus thing, and then on the fourth or fifth movie, John, oh my gosh. John, I'm sorry. I can't. John McGuire. Mm-hmm. John McGuire did those, and we kept trying to, be overly ambitious with those two things. And then Tim wanted to do a really heavy, completely like fully animated like thing. And so on 6-1, we knew we had the time. We had like 3 months, and he works at Bento Box. He works on Bob's Burgers. And so we said, okay, I want to do Saturday morning cartoon. And then so once he was working on that, it was just us coming back. Like, there's no development of this. It's just Tim and I working back and forth on it. And then I go, okay, Robbie, we're gonna do the Saturday morning theme song. And Robbie, being, I call him the mathematician when it comes to music, I'm like Paul Westerberg, and he's like frickin' Prince and Elvis Costello. He's like, okay, let me get my head around it. And he comes back with an arrangement. I'm going, oh my god, that's gorgeous.
Well, is the cast just as excited because the films are being finished up until, as you pointed out earlier, the last minute. So they've got to be just as excited to see, because when they're seeing it, they're just, I mean, you're furiously working on it. They're seeing it and they're finally seeing, like, here's the finished thing on the
big screen. Because luckily after the first movie, I mean, the first movie, no one knew what it was going to be. And you read stories about Ian and Tara going, we were just hoping this movie would go away because we didn't want our careers destroyed. They were just like, okay, I don't know what you're talking about. I don't know about a movie I did. And then it blew up, and then they were okay when because they didn't know when we were shooting it. Like, because a lot of stuff was like me running around going, and then there's a shark, rawr, you know, and a lot of stuff too. And since they hadn't done visual effects, you know, to get reactions, I had to basically jump around like a maniac and pretend that the Sharknado is coming. So it's like, okay, shark's coming, it's coming, it's coming, it's, ah! And then they would react. And so, like, you know, when you've never done that before, you're like, he's insane, and we're going to just go crawl in a hole and die.
So you didn't have like a stick with a ping pong ball in the end?
That doesn't work.
Any of that stuff? Yeah.
None of that crap works. I mean, sometimes we'll just say this is where it is, but it's you have to be in it. But I would do that a couple times. I go, okay, they get it. And then we do something again. And it's like, okay, there's the thing, the shark's there, and it's like, you're not going to do that thing again, Anthony? It's like, okay.
So they actually liked it.
but I've noticed like there's a thing, and I think if you look at our films compared to some other movies of this nature of people just standing around, I mean, their thing, and the sound hates me on this because I'll talk over things, but I get what I need out of it. Where I'll try to get someone work up by going, okay, now the Sharknado's coming. Okay, all right, it's coming. Okay, say your line. Ah! And then they'll do their line, and then it's like, all right, then the other one's coming to duck. And then so it's like it's all this stuff, but again, you see like the reactions and the stuff going on with it. And you know, look, Ian birthed himself out of a shark in the first movie, and I give him all the credit in the world because that could have been the end of everybody's career. That could have been the meme that destroyed everybody.
That scene where he's just sort of caught. I mean, I don't know how many takes you did of it.
Two.
Right. Yeah. Because just coming out covered in goop and blood, but like also delivering dead serious. I really feel that it's his. Him sort of keeping that the acting, you know, his acting style, you keeping him on point or however your working relationship is, it totally helps sell the movie. Because if he didn't act that way, if he was in on the joke, if he was winking, if he was sort of mugging in kind of a Bruce Campbell way, it would not have worked.
Well, they couldn't get anybody to be in the first movie. I mean, they went every single person in the... Everybody you could think of that they would went after, they went after, and then some. They went after, like, the people I remember, was like, you know, Steve Guttenberg and stuff like that. But then, you know, and the action heroes and stuff. But then they started going kind of wackadoodle with some of the offers. They went out to Dave Foley, which would have been a different movie.
Right.
And then the one that came kind of close was Crispin Glover. And I had a 30-minute conversation with Crispin Glover while we were location scouting in San Pedro. And it was like, he was like, I just don't understand. Like, why do you want me for this movie? It's like, because they made an offer to you. It's like, yeah, but why? You know, like, if I was going to play Finn, I'm going to play him as if he's like brain damaged, because I think that would make it interesting. I'm like, okay, Crispin, that sounds good. And I interviewed him before. He's a really nice guy, but I understood I think it was almost like he thought he was getting punked. Like, why do you want me to be an action hero? And, you know,
if
I do this, I'm doing it my way.
Right.
And it went on for 30 minutes, and then our connection got disconnected because of the we're out in the middle of San Pedro. And then I called him and said, I don't know if he's going to do this, but I lost connection with him. And then I guess no one ever heard from him again. But then they, you know, they were sending out offers under Sharknado, and then they changed it to Dark Sky. Guys, just so they can kind of go out to legitimate people. Mm-hmm. That John Hurt credit to that man. He was the first guy that we hooked, and he loved the project, and he believed in it from the beginning. And he always knew there was something about it, but he couldn't put his finger on it. And then that got us Terra. And then when they said Ian, I was like, of course, why didn't we go to him? For, like, the moment, that was one of those things where you just go, of course.
Right.
I mean,
right.
There was no, like, you know, there was no, like, yeah, but, you know, can he shave his head, or can he, you know, can he have grow a mustache? It was like, yeah. I mean, that was just like, it was like a no-brainer at that point.
Right, right.
And that was, I think that's how we got our core. And, you know, there's been a lot of very specificity things for me, being the tone police. You know, I get in and I rework the scripts, obviously, because that's, you know, I've done that on all my films. And, you know, when Scotty came in, one of the things I had to keep reminding him is that, you know, Finn doesn't ask questions. It's just, and that's something that Ian's been very clear about too. If you listen to how Finn talks, he's like, he never asks a question. And if he does, it's very, very, it has to be on the surface level, very, very simple. You know, Nova has been a very hard character for anyone to write but me. I understand Nova so well that a lot of that, you know, twisty language and all that stuff is because Cassie does it so well. And it's kind of like the way I talk sometimes, stream of consciousness. Cassie, the Nova character, is just like, I love that character so much.
Well, what's amazing about the sixth one is how it tied into what I thought was fantastic. Have you not seen all six of the Sharknado movies? There was recently a marathon. There was recently a marathon on Sci-Fi Channel, which you definitely should have checked out. But I mean, they're all like, you can get the Sharknado films. I mean,
it's on all five are on Netflix.
Yeah. And then the sixth one, I'm sure will end up being on Netflix. But I loved how the sixth one tied in with the first one and included John Hurd.
Yeah.
That was just, it was, you know what? And the ending was like the perfect ending to the series. Because remember you told me it was going to be the last one. I'm thinking, no way. It's like an event. I mean, I know people who actually have parties.
Yeah. Go to Twitter and you see like there's people that are genuinely invested in everything with these movies, which I feel like I have an obligation to not disappoint them. But one of the things that when we talked about time travel is I love Back to the Future Part 2 and that where they went into the first movie.
Right, right.
And we were trying to figure out how do we achieve that. And one of the things that everybody always bitches and moans about the smuggler ship thing at the beginning, the shark finning boat at the beginning of Sharknado 1. The thing is that with
I love that scene because it tells me it's serious. There are other ideas at play, and it actually comes off as a kind of a serious scene. It sets the tone and then tricks you.
Well, yeah. The thing about that was that it did a couple things that set a template moving forward, in that we did a mini movie. We did basically a drug deal, which was shark fins, shark finning on a boat, and then the Sharknado hit. So we were doing this subgenre at the beginning. And everybody goes, well, no, Finn isn't, no one's in it. It's like, yeah, but it does set a tone. And then every subsequent movie, our teasers became mini movies. Like they're complete short films before you even get to the main titles. And they kept getting longer to the point, like in at least in 4 and 5. I mean, it took 22 minutes before you saw the main title credits.
I love that though.
But since everybody bitched and moaned about it, it was like, well, fine. We're gonna go back to the smuggler's boat, and we're gonna put Finn on there and make it full circle.
It was perfect. It was perfect the way it tied in, and then the ending ends up being really heartfelt. I mean, even though like previous to that scene, Finn gets hit in the head with a kitchen sink.
Well, at that point, we're in the edit booth and we're going, just about everything's going on in here. I think my editor or somebody said, yeah, everything with the kitchen sink is like, yeah, we need to put that in.
And
we looked at producer Romali when we were locking, like, is it okay? It's like, yeah, sure, why not?
Do it.
Because the thing is like part of the thing too is it's why these things are so hard when people try to review them and they rip us to shreds.
Who would give a
but the thing is that I'm a critic. I understand, like, the thing is, every time anybody tries to rip these movies apart, I could rip them apart better than anybody. I was a critic for whatever, so I'm cognizant of
this. Do you want to review Sharknado 6 for Film Threat? You could do
a review of your own movie. No, I won't do that to my movie. I won't.
It would be up on Rotten Tomatoes.
That would be
hilarious. If it'd be very, very meta.
I wouldn't meta that because I care about these movies.
No, that's true.
But But the thing is, I would, because when I started shifting into film, the way I reviewed things is I looked at the pluses and minuses in a different way, as opposed to just going, you know, because sometimes, you know, you can just write a review where this sucks. But to write a review where you go, okay, I see what the filmmaker is going for. This doesn't miss the mark, but this is really genuine. This is good, and that's good. But on number two, we knew we were going to get, oh, they jumped the shark. So we just said, fuck it. I mean, sorry, language.
You can say it on the Film Threat podcast. Okay. It's okay.
Yeah, so you just go, screw it. We're going to have a thing where we do a shark, jump the shark mode, where they're jumping over sharks in the street, and then Mark McGrath goes, you know what you just said. You just, and then Finn goes, don't say it. So that way it's like, okay, you want to put that in your review? We already are aware of it.
Right.
And then, so that's kind of like the ending where everything is being thrown at you. It's like, you know, it's a kitchen sink. I mean, if we can't acknowledge that we just thrown every single thing, you know, Cleopatra, you know, spaceships, everything.
No, I was watching it in the bar and everybody just burst out laughing.
Yeah.
I mean, it was hysterical. It was perfect.
So, but then we got to the bar when we reset, we needed to go that far. So when we got back to the bar from 2013, that scene in the bar, I knew from the beginning. Uh-huh. I knew that from the fourth movie, I knew if I was going to end this where I wanted it to be, and I wanted to be back in the bar where everything was changed, meaning Finn is with April now. He's not, you know, he's not single or divorced.
Right. They never had a separation.
Yeah, they never had a separation. And the thing is, you talk about the silliness of the movies. This movie is kind of deep and interesting. Way Nova has her arc, which I think is fabulous.
Yeah.
But Finn
with her grandfather and all that. Yeah.
That's really powerful. But the driving thrust of this movie, aside from Tara's severed robotic head, is Finn has to go through time watching his son grow up without him. And if he's successful, Gil, his son, will never have existed. The hero has to sacrifice his son in order to save everybody in the world and to reset everything. And so when we get to the bar, him being with Tara and her being pregnant with a son that they're going to call Gil, it's poetic. Everything is going to work out, and they got a second chance. The John Hurt thing broke my heart because we knew we were doing the sixth one, and we knew that we were going to bring back people that died, and we knew we wanted. John Hurt was like top of the list. Yeah. John's coming back because we miss you, John. Mm-hmm. And then we were at Comic-Con. He was there the first year it blew up, and it was great hanging out with him. So he supported us from the beginning. But then we heard he passed at Comic-Con last year, and it just broke our hearts. Yeah. I mean, it was really sad. It was very hard for me. And Cassie, both of us, it meant so much to being in the presence of John and him being a part of it, but to not have him there. And so we kept trying to figure out how do we deal with this in the movie. And we got permission from Annika Hurt, his daughter, to say, can we use footage from the first movie? And so,
is it different footage?
It's pretty much the same footage.
Yeah.
And the thing that I think there might've been a reaction but other than that, everything's the same. But the thing about it that I think is so appropriate is that everybody has changed, like the Back to the Future, everything has changed for the better for everybody. But George is the only person that hasn't changed. He's doing the same things with the pregnancy of April running out of the bar with his stool.
With the stool,
He did when there was a Sharknado. So poetically, I think, John, wherever you're out there, you know, cheers to you. Mm-hmm. It's just appropriate that he's there and he hasn't changed. And that, I think that was the thing. And that speech at the end is a meta speech. It was written, I wanted to write something.
It was great. The thing with Al Roker also.
Well, that too. Yeah, it's twofold. So the
Ian
speech was, I wanted to write something. I wanted to write something that was going to the characters and about the journey we had over the 5 years. What works where Finn is talking to his family and his friends. But through him, I'm talking to my cast and crew and the fans at the same time. So if you really listen to the speech, it's really talking to everybody. It's saying goodbye. Me saying goodbye, myself, you know, saying goodbye to everybody. And then the button for Al Roker is, I was very clear that I wanted people to understand that nothing like, he says something to the effect of, it's perfect size everywhere, you know, so go out with the family, da 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 da. There'll be nothing ever quite like this again. And that was me saying, look, yes, whether you love or hate Sharknado, the fact that we were the success on a TV network that people can't remember whether it was a theatrical or a TV movie that went global, that talk show hosts used differently as punchlines or whatever, that on the cover of Newsweek it said Trump-Nado, We hit the zeitgeist globally with something that had no money to make and no marketing push whatsoever on the first movie, and the people that found us was the fans. And the fact that it was not based on an existing IP, that was not based on anything other than there's this title, and we created a mythology that everything that happens in every one of these movies, particularly the sixth movie, was earned. The fact that we have April's robotic head was established with what we did in 4 and 5. And so it's not something where we just go, this is stupid and ridiculous, let's do it. It's like, no, we have precedents. The idea of Terra clones was something I pitched in 5 to stop the Sharkzilla, because I felt that Gary Busey created, he had her DNA, he created an army of Terra clones. I was dead set that there was an army of Terra clones, and it got vetoed and rejected. It's like, no. And then when we started doing the sixth movie, it always happens that something's rejected, like the Sharknado sisters, and it comes back
just
in the next
shows
movie.
Up in the next movie.
And then the next movie, there was a whole subplot where it was the planet of the sharks, and it was, you know, them walking around, and there were shark people, and it was just, I just kept saying it's not working, and then Nova's falling in love with the shark person. It's like, number one, we couldn't achieve that digitally properly. We couldn't achieve it practically properly, and it's not driven by the characters. And then I said, and they go, well, and actually the network agreed on that. And then they go, what do we do? It's like, we do Planet of the Aprils. It's Terra. It's Terra clones. And that's what we have to do, because that story-wise, that works. And just the brain twist. Like, I understand all this. If everybody wants to know, like, I was on Twitter when I was live tweeting yesterday, there were people going, yes, but this, and this. I'm going, no, because this, and this. They're going, well, if she was pulled from the third movie timeline, then, you know, then all the other movies don't exist. It's like, because Gary Busey cloned her. So yes, this April could go back. And moving forward, it still works with the timeline. And still, it doesn't matter. The world explodes in number 5. So you still have to go and rectify everything.
Right.
So it's like, I've thought all this out. Even if we don't explain it in this movie, it's all thought out very carefully.
So all the sci-fi logic is there.
Logic as much as sci-fi has logic.
right.
You know, the thing we, you know, looping back through time once was something that was explains away why you can't. Because there was a thing of, well, they can jump to Noah's Ark, they can jump to this, and they know, let's keep it simple. Gil went through time once, and in order to go to the next time period, left Sharknadoes. So when he disappears, it's up to them now, when they went back, to stop those Sharknadoes. When he gives his little speech as the hologram, we purposely left out all the stuff he was saying with the little glitches. Mm-hmm. So we know what was said there, but because they think they only have to stop one, that's where they get confused. Mm. But he's pre-programmed it in that thing. So, I mean, it sounds stupid, but there's logic to these movies. And we establish in the fifth movie that you got to be careful about kissing Tara's head. You're going to blow her mind. And we pay that off in the sixth movie.
Oh, my God.
So there,
well, it reminds me of like the comedic tone and some of this. It reminds me of, I mean, this is a compliment, Red Dwarf.
Yeah.
Where in Red Dwarf, anything can happen. I mean, Red Dwarf is, you're familiar with that.
Yeah.
BBC series.
Yes.
And it has that sort of level of ridiculousness, yet grounded in logic. Absolutely grounded in sci-fi logic, where this does make sense. And Red Dwarf has that, and Sharknado has that, oddly.
Oh, I was always, like I said, I hate retconning in, mm-hmm. in any movie. I hate it when you have to do that. And it was hard for me with the Dolph Lundgren thing, because I knew we were going to piss a lot of people off. But that whole
I thought it was great.
That whole hologram
was
thing
awesome.
Wasn't in the original cut, but I had shot. I had shot some stuff with the intent that we would do it, and everybody kind of goes, we need the holograms. Like, yeah, you're right, we need the hologram to explain it, because it's, you're going to be cutting directly from the end of 5 into number 6. And the other thing, you know, we did change, the one thing that was great about time travel for us is we did change our Matt and Claudia, the kids, a couple times. So like so the first movie we had two actors, and then they over the course of 4 or 5 movies they changed to different actors playing Claudia and Matt. And then when we got the sixth one, we brought back the second Claudia and the first Matt. Because, and so the thing is that time travel explains now in our movie why they change. So one of those things that always kind of bothered me that we changed them, now I have that, like the retconning, it just actually kind of works for the logic of it. But we never took a shortcut. We always tried to make sure that you know, I like I said, I know these movies inside out. So whenever whenever something diverged, I was like, no, this is
okay. But wait, okay, I do have one question, which is going to sound like a Twitter question. But Judah Friedlander's character, when they go to the Middle Ages era or Camelot era, whatnot, like changes.
Yes,
you know, gender and ethnicity. Changes in it. Was that just a scheduling thing and you just thought you'd explain it in some was that actually in the script?
That was in the script, and it was because we wanted to show that if you mess with time, things can change radically, which is what we wanted to set up. I mean,
I thought that was going to like get even more and more.
And there was talk of like showing up and there would be different people playing Finn and April and all that stuff. But
I don't think that would have been a good choice.
Yeah. In the way we shot it, they never acknowledged that either of them changed, that they changed into different people, because technically they're just the same person, and that's what it was. And then April's severed head explained to them what happened, and it was just too much. So it's like, look, we got to rearrange those scenes so they acknowledge it. Otherwise, because every time we showed it to people, they're like, but wait, and it's like, people are going, but wait, they're not going to pay attention to everything else that comes after it. So we had to be concrete that they do recognize that the change happened because time travel. And that was also, again, just another Easter egg is in the animation, Judah gets hit with a lightning bolt or at the tail end of the animation as they're going through the portal in the pterodactyl. So that's another clue that something happened.
Oh, okay. Well, I have to say, having seen all six, Tara Reid, her performance in six, it's the most acting she's ever done. I mean, it's just like, first of all, I mean, two was crazy enough with getting her hand chopped off and then getting the blade on it and whatnot. But the sixth one, with her playing all of those Aprils, and the robot head April, and just like, all, I mean, how did she bother to keep it straight, or just like, just tell me what to do?
Every movie, you know, she always wants to do more, and we always, and I've been like really the one pushing, giving her action stuff, because I love Tara to death, and I just love that character. And so, you know, there were instances where, like, you know, it was like, oh, she's just going to be this. No, let's give her something. Let's, mm-hmm. you know, all that extra stuff that we did with her in the four where she became bionic, that cube truck that she's pulling, little Tara, that's her pulling it. Like, literally, like, we put the brake off and a little on an incline, but she's wanted to do it, and she's pulling, legitimately pulling that, and she was she wants to do this stuff. And so she goes, I want to do more in six. And I'm like, no, I have something I want to do for you. And she was game. It was so great, because it's like, Tara, can you be background in your scene for a clone? It's like, yeah. So she would say, it's delicious just to see Tara, like, standing behind Finn and Vivica as her own background. and she just, the Planet of the Aprils, she just slayed that
Planet
sequence.
Planet of the Aprils.
She just slayed it. Like, it was so, that was so much fun watching her just own it and get to play evil and then play Princess April and Head April. And yeah, look, honestly, I could probably safely say that thankfully the actors after you know the first movie trusted me, and they just go just like, even Ian would tell the other new people that come in, just trust Anthony, it'll work out,
right?
Because, you know, a lot of times I'm piecing things together as we're shooting it, and I know how they're going to connect, because you don't have time. You have 15 pages to shoot, and it's not dialogue.
Wait, 15 it's in a day?
Yeah, usually 10 to 15 pages a day. We have a 170 page script.
Oh my god.
And so you're literally compartmentalizing and figuring out how the sequences are going to cut together, and knowing when, okay, I could sacrifice the insert because I can get that in post, but I need the location. The Old West was shot in 2 days.
Oh my god,
all that Old West stuff,
that's like a huge chunk of the movie.
Yeah. And knowing how this stuff, like, so they kind of just go with it most of the time and go, okay, well, he's made it work before, he'll make it work here. It's brain calisthenics, as I call it. You know, so especially like the Planet of the Aprils, because it like that whole thing where they're cloning her and she comes out and all that stuff, and they scan her and all that. Mm-hmm. We did that in like 10 minutes. So it was like, okay, get a plate shot of this. Okay, great. Now let's get the double over the shoulder. Great. Now let's shoot her this way and do that. Let's have her scan the double here. And just getting those pieces, and we just get it done. You know, it, I
someone think, keeping track has got to be going crazy, though.
There's nobody. They never give us script supervisors.
What? You don't even have a script supervisor?
We've had.
Who is it? You playing double
Esther,
duty?
And it's Esther and I. My production supervisor and myself sometimes. But look, we've had scripties, sort of on one and two, part of three, but the thing is also. The way we operate, script supervisors has to be facile, and when they're not, they lose their minds. But no, on the sixth one, we had someone keeping track, but it, the way we do these movies, it's not easy.
Right.
It's almost like,
because I've been involved in that, where there's involved in projects where people, there's just an over-documentation, which ends up being a whole other job, where you're just like, you know what, just cut to the chase.
What I need is, I know, are we crossing the line? Did he have the thing in his hand, left hand or right hand? And so what we ended up doing a lot on this was I actually had an assistant on in Romania, and I had her with my iPad take photos of the
so you can just look and
yeah and
see.
So we go okay, he's positioned here, and that was the easiest way. There's this program I use a lot called Scriptation now, and I used to, with my scripts in the binders, I would go through like at the end of every week and highlight the stuff that we did, circle things, okay, I didn't get an insert here, and then I'd have that for my shot list of things we needed to pick up.
Right.
Scriptation actually is a lot better, because I actually real time I can kind of go through and mark up the script and go, okay, here I can make a note there. Even rewriting on the set, I just go in and type in the thing, and so then when they need the revised line, I have it right there. It's like I've totally went iPad, which I used to love having the hard script, but the iPad is just it's amazing, because what I could do is any changes I make in it, if we have a revised draft, I import the new PDF and it'll bring in all the changes from the previous draft. So all my markings and arrows and stuff. Script.
Okay.
It's a beautiful program, and I hope Final Draft adopts some of that stuff too, because you know I Final Draft is an amazing program and I use that all the time. But yeah, it's there. Everything is a workaround on these things. You just find what works to make it happen. We break Steadicam operators.
Like, really?
I warn them whenever they come on set. I go, you realize you're going to hate me by the end of the show, and we will break you at some point. And there's going to be an instant at the end of the day where you're going to be doing a 12-minute take. It's like, okay, what does that mean? and so there's a scene in, I'll do two examples. There's a scene in Sharknado 5. When I say we're doing, God, hopefully I'm doing this right. When I'm moving the microphone and I'm talking with my chin, so it's going to sound weird there. We usually are doing 2 to 3 action sequences a day, in addition to the dialogue. Maybe two, but whatever. But it's a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm. We're shooting in the Egyptian set in Bulgaria on number 5. And we have this set that we're never going to be able to recreate. You know, we had two areas we were shooting in, and it needs time to light. There's action. There's stuff that's going on. It's complicated stuff. And so when we get to the inner chamber, it's the end of the day, and we have about an hour. And we're trying to get in there, and we're trying to shoot this complicated thing, which is kind of like the end thing, where this machinery is falling apart. Finn's sticking a staff in there, and you know they're having dialogue conversations. And the dialogue wasn't really, when we got there, the dialogue was one area I didn't have time to look at really thoroughly. And we realized, oh gosh, this has problems. And we're gonna have to stitch this together later. So basically, I knew that we were gonna have to do close-ups to kind of explain a little bit more, because we realized they're talking about stuff outside, and how do they know the stuff's happening outside?
Right.
So we knew we could recreate the wall later. So we focused on the main thing. So it basically came down to, as I said, okay, main camera, stand down, steady, come with me. We have 15 minutes. The camera's turning on. Just follow me. And so we go, and I'm going, okay, Finn, go blah, 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 blah. Okay, now take this thing. Okay, we're getting a close up. Now stab this thing in there. Okay, great. Okay, now I got to get the reverse of that. Okay, all right, we're going to come back around with the gear shifts. And I'm sitting here spinning the gear shifts where the steady's going. Okay, now say your lines there. Oh my gosh, what's going on? The gear shifts. Okay, now going over here. Okay, two shots. Say your lines there. Okay, great. All right, move around, do this. And we did about 25 setups in 15 minutes. Cut, we had a wrap. And I'm going, there's, you know, in my head, I'm like, okay, it's a train wreck. It's never going to cut together. And we go back to the editing room, like, holy crap, that worked. Aside from the things we needed to pick up with the dialogue explanations and a couple little tiny inserts. It's like, holy crap. But those are those oners. There was another one in Romania where is the end of the day again, and we hadn't even started the scene, and everybody was cold, and every time everybody we yelled cut, they would go back to the heated tent. And if I had to cut every time to get everybody's coverage, I knew that we would never make our day, and we were never coming back to the castle set. So rolled camera. That was probably a 15-minute take. Got a master, went in, got a medium, got a close on each person, one take each, got inserts, got the end of the scene, and it just kept going. And that was probably like 30 setups.
Oh my God.
But it cuts together somehow. But that's the things we do because we don't have $100 million. We don't have 100 days to make our film.
Well, I mean, if you had that kind of money, if you had $100 million to make a Sharknado movie,
I'd be Clint Eastwood. I'd be like a lot of that superfluous bullshit stuff cut out because, it honestly, there's a lot of waste that goes in these movies. There's things you have to do right for safety. You have to do stunts. Green screen takes time. Action stunts, all that stuff takes time. But when it comes to the performance and the drama, if you got a full day to do three pages, there's no reason why that should bleed into a second and a third day. And I always hear people going, yeah, you know, it was really hard on our indie film. We only had 30 days and we just didn't have enough money. It's like, oh gosh, you shouldn't be making films then.
Two people talking in a room.
Yeah.
It's and like, you shoot for a month.
I think that some of the, like I said, I'd love to have time to do things properly and to set it up, but I also think that, you know, that you don't need to do 10 takes for a master. Do one or two, and then you go in for coverage and you find the magic in that. And there's energy that comes from the way we do it. I always call it an energy of desperation. I would love to have time and money to do something. I'd love to do a Marvel movie. You know,
Wait. Right here.
Yeah.
You want to do a Marvel movie.
I would love to do a Marvel movie. I think
there's an opening right now for Guardians 3, but that's probably not the best way to.
No, well, I would never take that. That's James Gunn's thing. That's James Gunn's
movie. I know.
But Moon Knight has been my favorite Marvel character, and I love that character.
Why don't you just go pitch it?
Yeah. Well, gotta.
Moon Knight.
Yeah, Moon Knight would be awesome. It's one of the most underrated.
Wait, who has Moon Knight?
It's Marvel.
No, but Marvel has it because, you know, the rights are
Marvel. Marvel owns it.
Okay.
Marvel owns Moon Knight. Well, the rights reverted back.
Phase four, right? We're in phase four now?
Yeah.
We're going to be in phase four after the Infinity War?
Yeah. No, Moon Knight, there's two rules. The thing they might be easing into is they might be making it part of their Netflix brand because on Luke Cage, they had the Bushman appear in this new season. Mm. And Bushman is a Moon Knight villain. So Moon Knight kind of fits into that New York universe that they have. But as a movie, everybody calls Moon Knight like the poor man's Batman and stuff, which is like, I disagree. Moon Knight's schizophrenic. He has five split personalities, but you know, there's DC has a hard time with their rogues gallery sometimes. They have their core, like two or three, but when you kind of get down into it, like, you know, Clayface and stuff, it's like, and some of that stuff doesn't necessarily translate. Moon Knight has the most amazing rogues gallery. Like, you could do three or four movies and you would hit characters that are amazing for film that you would have never thought, oh, wow, I didn't realize this guy had so many good. Doug Mensch, I can't pronounce his name, Doug Mensch and J.M. DeMatteis. They did the original run in the early 80s. And, you know, Stained Glass Scarlet, The Bushman, Midnight Man. I mean, they were horror comics. And yet there's something really interesting and fascinating about this. And he's gorgeous as this white knight, you know, Specter. His alter ego is Mark Specter. And it's just, he's great. It's a great character. And it's that stuff that Marvel does really well, where they take something you wouldn't expect could work, like Ant-Man or Guardians, and you do it right, and you know how to, it integrates into the rest of your franchise. And he's a great character, and he deserves to be on film. And ever since I've been a kid, I've wanted to make Moon Knight. And now that Marvel's so big, I'm like, this is gonna get big enough to I can make Moon Knight before someone else does.
Oh God, the dream character that I'd like to either see made or make myself, maybe as a fan film, is Machine Man.
Machine Man.
Jack Kirby,
the purple,
the purple,
robot.
Yeah, Yeah, you know, I remember Aaron that. Stack X51.
Yeah.
Like, it's a Pinocchio story. It's Pinocchio. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's Pinocchio with this bizarre android. And I don't know. I've always loved Machine Man. And I don't know. I'd just like to see Machine Man made.
If it was a DC character, the character I'd love to make is Sandman, the Neil Gaiman.
Oh, wow. Yes.
Because that or even The Death, The High Cost of Living, those two books are fantastic. And that character is so interesting and arty and artistic. And, you know, I know they've been trying to develop Sandman for a long time and it just hasn't happened. But I love that character. That of the DC, that one is really fascinating. But there's a lot, you know, I mean, I think we're into a world now where it doesn't just have to be all Superman, Batman, and that's what Marvel has proven.
Right, right.
Yeah, and I think that's kudos to them, because everybody kept going, "Oh, Guardians is never going to be successful. Ant-Man's going to tank." And like, they're fun.
There's
movies.
A second Ant-Man movie, and Ant-Man's obviously going to be in Infinity War Part 2.
Ant-Man and the Wasp has that breezy tone of Sharknado, but they have the money and the resources to make everything look amazing.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not embarrassed by what we do, but we do it with what we have. We have chewing gum and duct tape.
Yeah, if that.
Robbie always said, it's a movie that doesn't know it can't do that. And I think that that's the magic of these movies, is that we've been successful even though we shouldn't be able to be successful. And the fans, like I said, they love us. They love, it's not because they hate us. They actually genuinely just like that these movies are fun. And I think that's why Marvel's movies work, because they're fun. They're not trying to tell some kind of political agenda or anything. I mean, of course it got dark at the end of Avengers, but they're designed as escapism. And there's all forms of escapism. Obviously, when we were growing up, horror movies, we would watch Sam Raimi movies.
Oh God.
You know, they what Sam Raimi did, what Peter Jackson did, Carpenter, Cronenberg, Joe Dante, they were fun. Piranha, rough around the edges, but entertaining film.
But I'm not a fan of the trend in horror where it's torture porn.
Oh, that's where I draw the line.
I'm just not into it. It's not. This isn't fun to watch. This isn't. Where's the redemption? Where's the?
It's the weird thing is, like, because there's this argument, like, if you think about it, like, when you could say I hate torture porn, but yeah, well, the Jason movies did this and that, and they were gory. And yeah, but here's the thing. It's one thing where Jason takes a sleeping bag and slaps the person inside the sleeping bag up against a tree because it's ridiculous and it's kind of dark humor, as opposed to him taking a corkscrew and spending 10 minutes jamming it into the eyeball of the camper and then pulling off the fingers one by one and the limbs and then hitting the remaining lifeless body up against the tree.
Yeah.
One of them is just like ridiculous, and yes, those movies were gory, but there's something about them and I can't explain it. I think one is to make you squeamish and uncomfortable. The other is like, this is just escapism. But you could say that both are torture porn, but I it's weird. I mean, maybe I'm being a hypocrite, but
no, I think torture porn, you definitely know it when you see it. It's when they're gratuitously hurting someone. I mean, when it's done in a jokey way, like a Freddy way, or in the Evil Dead films or whatnot, I've always found those entertaining, or at least with Cronenberg, at least, where there are ideas behind it. But I want to back up and actually talk about between the first and the second film.
Yeah.
No one knew, literally, like the characters in the first Sharknado, no one knew this was coming, because I remember it was either... Was it before San Diego Comic-Con or after? I remember this is 2013, and Sharknado, I remember seeing people talking about it on Twitter, had to see it. And I think that it was one of those things they played back-to-back. And Twitter went nuts when the first Sharknado happened. One, because I think the title's ridiculous, so that, like, obviously that attracted people to see it. But secondly, just people went... I want to talk about how it became a phenomenon, and then how it became a thing that so many people... I made a list of some of the people that have been in the Sharknado movies. There's a lot of famous people in the movies. But so that happened. That happened almost immediately with the second film. But how did Sharknado become a phenomenon? And how much of it was... I mean, obviously you promoted it because you're on social media and you promoted it, and Sci-Fi Channel promoted it, you know, but they didn't promote it. Did they know what they had?
No.
Tell me, how did it become this movie that you made with chewing gum and duct tape into a phenomenon? Because it became a phenomenon when the second movie came out, people were ready for it. I mean, I was waiting.
It was already successful at that point. I mean,
how did it get in the zeitgeist, right?
I've done enough of these movies, written a few with sci-fi as a director, that you know that Saturday night movie thing, they come and they go. Occasionally something kind of gets out there, like Mansquito. There's a handful of people that make a joke, oh, Mansquito's coming on, or Sharktopus or whatever. Mm-hmm. But you know they're going to come and go. I mean, it's inevitable. It's not like you're sitting there going, yes, we're going to break Twitter or anything like that. Sharknado, no one will ever fully be able to understand what was in the water with it, but there are several things that I always say that are part of the puzzle. And I think that the truth is somewhere in between this puzzle. So, number one, we cared, a lot of people care about the movies, but I was not a director for hire that said, I'm just doing this movie, okay, Sharknado, let's do this. I mean, I believed in this title, I wanted to make a crazy movie, and I was like, look, if I destroy my career with this movie, I'm going to go down with flaming sharks. Just let's go big or go home. Cylum, God bless them. I think that one of the great things we talk about, like companies that don't know how to do these movies, again, they want to make them really like simple because they understand that. Asylum wants to be ambitious. And so the danger in hiring someone like me is like they want to be ambitious and so do I. And I'll find a workaround to get us as ambitious as we can. They never once ever go, yeah, but no, we don't want to do that because there's a helicopter. No. They make a mandate. They say, here's a $100 million script to their line producers. Okay, figure it out, guys. And so that's one of the strengths of that company is that they're not afraid to try to be ambitious. And that's what we attempted to do with this. I've done a horror, but I've never done a big action visual effects movie. So I had a lot to prove. And I wanted to really pack it because I had seen what had happened to some of my other scripts where they kind of just got gutted because ones I didn't direct,
right?
Because there was obviously limited resources or whatever, and it's like, so I knew that you can do this. It's just you have to be smart about it. So that's one thing. I think having John Hurt, Tara Reid, and Ian Ziering in the film is a big component because they were not people that you would associate with these kind of films. That was like a holy trinity of like people like, wow, they're doing this. There must be something about this. That's another one. When we saw their Asylum likes to play everything kind of straight and they'll have their goofy moments, but there's certain lines that are drawn. And one of the things that I kept at bay until the very end was kind of showing my card about Finn going into the shark, Crouching Tiger, Hidden Dragon style. In the original script, it was he's on the ground and the shark chomps him and then he chainsaws his way out. It's like, no, we're going full Crouching Tiger. And I remember there was a moment when I was showing this to one of the producers and they're going, is that a little too far? It's like, no, it's not. Yeah, I think it's okay. And that became the meme. When it was all put together with all the visual effects, we were working on this thing to the bitter end. And we did 18 days, but every other week I was out with a GoPro or another camera shooting little pickups and inserts, just like simple things like the girl in the water. We never had a chance to do the surfer in the water. So I went out with a GoPro in a wetsuit and I'm following her in the ocean with this fin. And so there's these little tiny pieces, like a lot of times you don't have the inserts to make a movie. We shot inserts all the time to make the movie better because we didn't have time to do it during the initial round. So when it was all together, I watched it 2 weeks before and I was with my editor and a friend and I said, you know, this is probably the craziest movie that sci-fi's ever had. And it's probably the greatest stoner movie ever made. And maybe in 5 years, you know, it could be a cult film because we're laughing and having fun with it and we made it. And because it's all together, because there's a lot of holes to be filled with visual effects. So I think that's part of it. Asylum put together a really great trailer that looked like a theatrical trailer. Sci-fi's trailers at the time were like really short and like, mm-hmm. Here's a Sharknado, oh my gosh, and that's it. Theirs was theatrical and they usually waited for after the movie aired for them to allow the sub studios to put their trailers out. And I said, have them, let us put the trailer out early. And they, Sci-Fi says, that's fine, go ahead and put it out. They put it out, and people looked at it going, that looks like pretty cool. I mean, it looked huge. If you look back at that first...
So this is the first trailer to the first Sharknado.
You go back and look at that first trailer, and you go, this is the most ridiculous thing, and that looks ambitious. They're daring me to watch this to see that they have nothing else up their sleeve. Right. Yet we had tons more stuff in the film, more so than that. So I think that was another component, that getting that trailer out early. Robbie and I wrote the theme song.
So it was like a month early?
No, like a week.
A week
2 weeks,
before.
2 weeks or weeks before.
And like, so it blew up on YouTube.
So that was thing. We did a music video. Everybody says, don't do a music video for the song. So Robbie and I went out and made a music video for the Ballad of Sharknado. And we had people doing silly things on the Venice Boulevard and all that stuff. And we put that out. I created a Facebook page and we promoted it that way because I know about grassroots stuff. Mm-hmm. Sci-Fi wasn't going to do any press on it. And I said, and I knew, being a journalist, like they a lot of the times on the Sci-Fi movies, they would do a conference call scrum with, you know, a handful of reporters. I go, look, I can get Tara Reid and myself, we'll do it the day before, just, you know, just set it up. It's like, okay, we'll set it up. And they set it up, and we did. It was funny because I remember I was doing some journalism thing that Wednesday, and then I stepped out and I did the interview with Tara on the call, and then they started running those stories. When I knew there was something really weird going on was when my editor on Boo, Chris Connolly, who also helped a little bit out on Sharknado, he calls me up going, yeah, I was in 7-Eleven and people are talking about Sharknado. I'm like, Chris, come on, really? No one's talking about it. You misheard it. They're talking about something else. No one in 7-Eleven is randomly talking about our film. It's not possible. So that was all the lead up. And I know Gary Morgenstern at Sci-Fi had got Daily News to do a little tiny write-up on it. But there was nothing, there wasn't anything. It was the typical.
There was no press at the beginning other than the trailer.
All this minimal stuff. It was grassroots, 100%. Mm-hmm. And there was a title that people heard and thought it was weird. That was also a summer where there's a lot of dark movies in a movie theater. A lot of dark films. And there was like, here was something.
Yeah, Man of Steel came out that year. Talk about dark movies.
Man of Steel basically has the same exact scene that we have in our film, where there's a tornado and a pile up of cars and a dog that needs to be saved. And we did the same exact thing in Sharknado with probably one 700th of the budget. I thought it was so weird. It was like, literally, wow, they just did an asylum scene, you know? And Kevin Costner bites it, in our movie George bites it. It was one of those things where it was in the ether. And so I think people wanted something that was free, that was like, you know what, I could turn my brain off, let me watch it. And people found it, and then celebrities started tweeting about it.
Yeah, I remember seeing Patton Oswalt tweeting about it, but not just tweeting about it, he was going on a rant. Like,
yeah, Mia Farrow wrote about it. Judah Friedlander, who ended up in the second and sixth movie, like, he wrote, yes, I directed Sharknado under the pseudonym of Anthony C. Ferrante. And then I wrote back, yes, I starred in 30 Rock under the pseudonym of Judah Friedlander. And we became friends after that. But when we were doing it, like, I was just going to go on Twitter and live tweet. And I knew that it was kind of a thing of, like, okay, I'm going to kind of like do director commentary and tweeting, and then I'm going to get a lot of, you suck, Ferrante. I mean, that's basically what I expected. And then all of a sudden, like, you know, I'd be trying to keep up with the tweets, and it would be going, it's like 100 tweets. Like, and I click on one, and then, as everybody kept, you know, I was there with my family and some friends, and I'm going, hey, Mia Farrow's tweeting, and this is happening. And after it was over, I knew something had happened, but I didn't quite know what. I knew something was wrong.
And I remember there were articles the next week.
It was the next day, like that. I was driving to see the crew screening afterwards, uh-huh. And I get a call from BuzzFeed going, why are you calling me? How to get my number? It's like, oh, we got to talk about what happened with Sharknado. Like, okay. And then I'm sitting there watching it with the crew, and I get a call like, they want you on CNN tomorrow. Because Ian was doing Chippendales and Tara was in Mexico, like they needed people to talk to. So I on that Friday, I went from like the local, one of the seven stations here in LA, like ABC or something, to CNN, to NBC Nightly News, to Dateline, or not Dateline, Nightline on ABC. I remember talking to the guy from there, Fox, E, I'd never done anything like that. I like went from one thing to another. I just drove around Los Angeles doing interviews all day. And a Hollywood Reporter called and did it. It was like eerie, but because I'd been on the other side of it.
I was well trained.
You want me to do that? Sure, I'll be there because it's promotion. And so the first one, the ratings weren't as big as they thought based on the tweets. Then they re-aired it, so it was like a 1.3. You had to check the numbers, and then it increased on the second viewing to like a 1.5 or 6. And then the third airing, because it continued for 2 weeks, nonstop people talking about it, the third airing, we were like 2.1. We actually increased in ratings, and then they did a midnight showing, or they did a theatrical showing at I think through Fathom Events, and it sold out across the country. So it was just things that don't happen with this movie. And I think it's just people were craving something that was just, it was free and it was entertaining. And the other part of it is it's despite limbs getting ripped off, it's strangely family wholesome values.
No, that's what's weird about it too is, I mean, there are some gory, bizarre, weird, sick things that happen, right? But it's, yeah. but it's,
there's never,
there's a tone that it's not done in a way that's creepy or,
There's never a moment where two people go, let's go have sex in the woods and then Sharknado attacks. We never did that.
Oh, yeah. There was no...
And also there was stuff, too. Like, I talk about, like, the characters with Finn and Nova. And originally, Finn and Nova had this weird, creepy thing going on. And, like, her picking up on him and Finn, like, flirting with him. And, like, no. Finn still cares about April. You can't have that ending if he's like off the beaten track. Yes, he's looking at the surfer and there's a little bit of that. But there's the thing I'm most proud of in the first movie is what we did with Nova and how Finn is completely oblivious to Nova actually flirting with him. There's a thing where in the bar, she goes, who's this? And he goes, it's my wife. And he says, ex-wife. He says, my wife. And it's like, Nova's like, tell me you had an ex-wife. And he just never acknowledges it. If you look at it, he just completely ignores that comment from her.
Right, right.
And then later in the movie, it's like, he goes, yeah, I got to get my son. He's like, you never said I had a son. It's like, okay, we're going to go do this. And so that became a running gag with this sort of thing with Nova, even in the third movie where she was in the second one and she's like, April's having a baby. Oh, you're having a baby. But the satisfaction of what we did with Nova is there's a moment in the when he's suiting up to the astronaut and they're having this talk and April's over in the corner and they're talking or whatever. And in the original script, Thunder wrote Nova plants a big passionate kiss on Finn. And it's like, no, that's not happening. That's not happening because that's not what's supposed to be happening in this thing. And when we played the scene, it's a scene of, it's her finally realizing, acknowledging now we get this, car.
Yeah. If you can hear it, there's a car that's, we're in Los Angeles.
So, at that moment, she acknowledges that she loves Finn, but she loves Finn as a friend, and she worries about him because she sees April and she understands. And it's the first time that it's like there's no more jealousy. It's done. I can go on. And I whispered into Cassie's ear, and I said, and I didn't tell Ian this, and it's on Ian. And I whispered to Cassie, I said, at the end of the scene, just jump up and give him just a big hug. And she does that. And Ian is just thrown off by it, but it's such an honest, genuine moment, and you feel like you get that she cares about him. And so the course of all these movies is as much as, like, in the fifth movie, Nova's, off on her own psycho agenda with the set Sharknado Sisterhood, and they're talking about stuff like this. Like, you're always going to save your family. It's like, no, I need this. I needed this. We're on separate paths. And by the end of that movie, she's dying, it says, no, we're family. And by the sixth movie, that's paid off with, at the end, where it's like, look, thank you for the college loan. And the thing is, there's no sexual tension anymore because it's, she's part of the family. And again, it's these subtle little things. And the kids love these movies. I've signed at conventions and it's like, they come up and they know these movies inside out. And every parent say, yeah, my 6-7-year-old loves these movies. And we've always felt an obligation. So I think they have this ADD kind of like, way they're written, like, and then he goes into the shark and then he chainsaws his way out. There's this sort of weird, unfettered imagination that happens with Sharknado, that it's stream of consciousness and you're allowed to do it because it's Sharknado, and the kids have been attracted to it. And families have parties. It became sci-fi Super Bowl.
It's every since the first one, you plan for when it's going to So
you're asking how the phenomenon. So the phenomenon grew up until the third airing of the film, and then the theatrical was the button, mm-hmm. and that's when it became full blown. This is a real thing. It didn't.
That's when there was a sequel that was.
Well, it was greenlit right away. It greenlit a little bit after that, but it was solidified in that. Everybody thought after the first day that it was going to go away. Even the producers like, yeah, it'll blow over. But it went on for the rest of the summer. It aired in July, and people were still talking about it by the end of August. That doesn't happen with a made-for-TV movie.
It doesn't happen with the theatrical films. We eat pop culture so quickly now. It's like, this movie, Ant-Man and the Wasp, this, whatever. They come and go, which is really actually disheartening, I think. Because a lot of good films will get passed over, and then I feel like we had a longer time to discuss before the next thing kind of took our attention.
Well, and that's the thing, is it grew, and that people who heard about it had to see it, and then we got fans that ultimately embraced and loved us for what it was, because we're not pretending to be anything else. People get so bent out of shape with these films. It's like, there's nothing to get bent out of shape about. They're designed as entertainment.
Well, yeah. there is in part two, to be fair. There is a little nitpick I have in part two.
All right.
Which is, Tara Reid gets her hand chopped off by the shark. They end up finding the same shark, and they pull her arm out, which still has the gun and her ring on there, the engagement ring.
Yeah.
And the arm's too long. It's the shark just bit off the hand, not the whole arm up to the elbow. Anthony.
It grew in a shark's mouth.
Come on, no, I'm not the first person that's nitpicked about that one, right?
That's sleight of hand.
Exactly. Okay, ba-dum-bum. Okay. Well, it's sort of like moving Kylo Ren's scar from one place to the next between Force Awakens and Last Jedi. They just completely moved where the scar was.
If that's what you're nailing me on with Sharknado,
That's my only beef with the Sharknado movies is Tara Reid's bit off hand in the second one. But now,
But when we decided that's what was happening, we had planned that, and then things kind of got adjusted.
Whatever.
It is what it is.
Look, look. If that's my biggest complaint, that's a stupid complaint. But it's nitpicky. But okay.
Well, the other complaint I just never understood. It's like, sharks can't survive in a tornado. And I go, yeah, cars don't turn into robots. So we draw the line at sharks in a tornado. So I would say that I would, after the first movie, I'm going, you know what? And it was great that people would keep getting hung up on. I'm going, they're not sharks. It's not a tornado. It's a Sharknado. And that's our villain. And you know what we're going to tell you right now? It's going to do whatever we tell it to do. So it could take down that airplane. It could go into space. Screw you. It's a Sharknado, and that's our villain, and that's what we're sticking to.
No, okay, so then after the first film, it's obviously a full-blown phenomenon. It's huge. The second movie's greenlit right away. You now have to work with Thunder, and Thunder's got to write the script, and you got to get it all together. And obviously you contribute to that, ideas and whatnot about where it should go. And those will be used in the next movie, of course, because that's following that rule. But now there's a big Richard Kind. You've got Judah Friedlander, Mark McGrath. You've got the cast of the Today Show, which obviously there must be a tie-in with NBC Universal, Comcast kind of thing, tied in with that. But I mean, clearly if the cast of the Today Show didn't want to do it, they wouldn't have done it. They're having so much fun. I mean, so tell me, when did it suddenly, like, people are, and even myself, you know, that is one of my life's greatest regrets. Never getting killed in a Sharknado movie. Okay, you know, but I fully believe, I know you say the sixth one is the end, and this is maybe the end of this incarnation of Sharknado with this cast.
Yeah.
I think there's going to be a seventh one. I think J.J. Abrams is going to come back to reboot it. I think Kathleen Kennedy will produce, and I think it'll be huge budget.
And there'll be 14 directors.
Yeah, 14 directors, and it'll be changed. But I do think that there's a little suggestion of that about, like, a reboot. Am I wrong? Is there, because I feel like you could almost make a Sharknado 7 and make fun of reboots, but actually reboot, like actually have it be a new cast have Finn be like the Luke Skywalker of that next six. George Lucas said there were only going to be six Star Wars films. Obviously, he lied to us.
Here's the thing.
They're now nine.
Look, I keep telling people, I lived through two Final Friday the 13th. I get it. But
there's got to be a seventh. But to make fun of reboots.
Yeah, but it's not about no. But the thing is, that's not every time we start a Sharknado. It's not we have ridiculous ideas, but it goes. What is the story? Right. I know no one believes it, but what is going on with Finn and his family? And if you look at each movie, it's a progression. It's a progression of redemption for Finn throughout the course of all these movies. So you have to find what the story is. Otherwise, then it is just a succession of gags. The thing is that I never wanted to like not do one of these movies and it be the final one and not being able to say goodbye. I've said goodbye. I've said everything I needed to say about Sharknado. Now, when and if the reboot or the next iteration happens, I would love to be a part of it.
Okay, well, if you were going to do part 7, what?
That's another rule is that even though we make jokes, we never talk about the next one until we're done with this one. And at this
point, right? So you're not going to say anything?
No, because I don't have a single idea. I at this point we've done everything. There are other things to do, but I don't know what that is right now. It needs to sit on a shelf for a while until we figure out what is the next thing. I mean, there's a lot of characters you could spun off. I mean, clearly the time
could be Shark Trek, Shark Wars.
Well, the time travel element to me is like Gil spent a lot of time in time. I mean, and I think the time travel is just so much fun. Mm-hmm. That, if you were going to do something, I mean, tell stories within that. Sharknado's across time. There's so many remaining things. That's an interesting TV show. That's an interesting something else that you could do.
Yeah, like Doctor Who, but with Sharknados.
Yeah. So I mean, there's a lot of Nova would make an interesting spinoff if they did something. Gil obviously has 80 different actors playing him over the course of three movies. He obviously. There's more to tell there. I would never. The only thing I would never want them to do is to go. Finn Shepard never existed, and da 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 da. If they did it, at least try to keep a tiny bit of continuity. Whatever that may be.
Right.
So now
with the second movie, and now with all the movies post the first one. People are now, they really want to be in it. Like, are people pitching themselves to be in it? Like,
they just have a casting director and they go down the list. And again, I always tell people, it's like, it's not that we couldn't fit someone in. It's just, could we fit them into our schedule? We don't have 100 days. We have 18 days. So a lot of times it's like, oh, by the way, Richard Kind's in your movie. I was like, okay, that is at 10 o'clock at night before we're shooting the next day.
But that's such a great scene. The Richard Kind scene, how he tells this story about his dad.
I give a lot of props to my buddy, Jay Frasco. So we were doing this and I called up Thunder. I go, we got Richard Kind. We need to write something. And he was like, he was asleep and groggy. And it's like, okay, that's not happening. And I'm prepping the next day. And this was the Met Stadium day, which was like military planning.
Right.
And so I knew what I wanted to do with him and I knew how I wanted it to go. And I want, cause we were always planning on doing the natural gag, but we wanted to do it with with one of the Mets coaches, but that wasn't going to happen. Mm-hmm. And, I wanted to have the scene with Judah and him. And so I called Jay at 11 o'clock at night. I go, Jay, okay, here's what I need. I need you to sketch something out for me because I have no brain cells and I'll take it and I'll rework it. Just like, and he goes, okay, I'll do that. He did it as a favor for me. And so he did that while I was finishing up the stuff I needed to prep the night before. I got it. Then I reworked it, went to set, worked with Richard and Judah before we went to set and rewrote it there. And then we went out. So within less than 6 hours, probably 6 to 8 hours, we went from having nothing to something permanent on film. And it's sweet. And
it's a great story. It's baseball, father-son relationships, yeah. The whole thing with like Judah recognizing him. It also involves redemption. Yeah. Like it's weird to say like all of this in this one scene, but they pull it off. I mean, Judah just, hands off and then Richard Kind just nailed it because he's so serious and so like, oh my God, like.
But I think the thing that happened, it's like you do these things and then you get punished for it later. It's like, oh, they did that. Next time we're going to give them 4 people that they have to write for the next day. And that became like the subsequent movies where we would last minute.
Just being thrown all kinds of people.
We get stuff and then you just like, I think, I give credit to the cast and I give credit to the crew to just kind of going with the flow of making these things work because magic comes out of a lot of these little moments. I mean, the Alaska who plays Morgana in Six, like she came out on set, literally got off the plane and showed up on set, never acted in a movie before, done her own little things on YouTube and stuff. And she didn't know the lines until she got out there, looked at them, and she just nailed it. She just slayed it. And so within that, her being able to just kind of read this and be able to be into it, I was able to like pull moments out. Like when she's sword fighting with Finn, I'm like, oh, you got to blow him a kiss. We got to get a close up of his big like red lips. And he did it. She did it, and it was fantastic. And then in Merlin's castle, like she's saying these lines, and she's going, you know, won't have sway over the such a powerful tool. And I'm like, all I kept thinking of was Tim Curry from Rocky Horror. I'm going, you got to drag out Tool. And so it's, and she just did it. She goes, Tool. And it was like that. If you think about it, it's really Tim Curry from Rocky Horror. And that's what I heard in my mind. But she was doing stuff. And I'm like, of course. And it was never a thing. She just went for it. And she did it. The whole arguing with getting the people to come in with the Excalibur sword, mm-hmm. and just having her improv all that stuff was just funny. Oh, honey, oh, you chosen one, you know, okay, good job, honey. It's just like, that stuff is those nuances that make the movies work, you know, because they're in the moment.
Well, tell me a little bit about what are some of the other cameos that stand out? I mean, you had Lloyd Kaufman.
Robert Hayes.
Robert Hayes.
Robert Hayes changed everything because everybody was out to get us on two. I mean, because they...
Why?
No, because I think everybody was excited, but I think they're just like, they can't replicate this. They can't do this. And
oh, no. Two is like...
It's the best of all of them.
It's my personal favorite, but... That opening scene, what is it, like that 10-minute like airport scene, oh my God, and then you get to the credits. I was like, oh, see, to me, I also think that that's what made it a franchise, was that second movie. It's sort of like with anything, it's like, okay, you get caught lightning in a bottle with the first movie, great, but is there a second movie? Second movie's better than the first and solidified that, yes, there will be more coming of this. I mean, that's true with any franchise, you know?
I look at Sharknado 2, it's Evil Dead 2 of our franchise. And yeah. You know, it's basically, we kind of redid the first movie, but with more resources and money. It's instead of LA,
and in
New York.
Yeah.
And we got to do amazing locations and all that stuff. But Robert Hayes popping up in there, it's like, we saw they showed it to the TCA critics before it aired at a sort of a swimming party at swimming pool party out at the Beverly Hilton. And it's on, and like, you know, they're watching it, you know, you're seeing, okay, they're going, okay, what are they going to do? And then Robert Hayes shows up, and it's like, we earned so much goodwill, because it's like, all right, they get it. They know what they are. Like, it's like, you have Robert Hayes playing the pilot in Sharknado 2, okay. And that was like, that was so awesome. And so, you know, that was a thing, and it was the highest rated Sci-Fi Channel movie in their history, and it hasn't been supplanted for Sharknado 2. We had everybody paying attention to us. They were watching us, and it became an event, and we upped the ante. But again, if you look at it, it's about the characters. That moment on Empire State Building, the one that you have a problem with the arm, is one of the most ludicrously absurd, morbid, romantic scenes in the history of film.
No, it's weird. He gets down there and he pulls the ring off. The bloody ring with chunks of flesh just like pulls it off and puts it on her. I mean, it was just so great. I mean, it's just so... I mean, you can't describe
these.
But yeah,
so you asked about the success. I think these are hopeful movies. I mean, even when there's been a cliffhanger, mm-hmm. they're films where there's hope. There's hope for the everyman. There's hope that families can stay together. That's what these films are, and it's weird, but that's what it is. And I wouldn't change anything, because I'm very attached to these movies. Some of them have worked better than others, but we've went on huge adventures and we kept doing things that nobody could do. We went to Kennedy Space Center with a crew of six people and shot in Mission Control and in Vehicle Assembly Building and where the Apollo astronauts.
Wait, it's Bobak's in that scene, right? Or is that
he's in the shuttle.
He's okay, yeah.
But he wasn't. But that like the. Transformers went there before us, and they had like $100 million, and they needed a super crew. And they said, "Look, if you can come with a crew of six, we can shoot this." That's why I'm in the scene, because we needed an actor to play the head of NASA, and the line producer
with a tie. I've never seen you with a tie.
The line producer couldn't do it, and everybody else had been in the movie somewhere that was with us. So I had to be the head of NASA, and Ian's coaching me. You know, it's just weird. You know, we shot at amusement park. You know, I mean, Universal Orlando, like most amusement parks don't want you destroying them. And they had very specific rules. They say, look, the sharks can destroy things, but there can't be anything that happens to the actual things right. because of whatever. And that was great. And you couldn't shoot certain IP. But I went there and scouted, and I saw the Ferris or the roller coaster. I'm going, oh, loop-de-loop. Shark needs to go loop-de-loop, and there needs to be the car that goes and flies into the Twister ride. It's just Looney Tunes. And so we traveled the globe in number five countries in 2 months with the same budget we had on the fourth film. Oh, and we have filmed in front of Trevi Fountain. So I think a lot of these things, I think the magic of them is that we're not just, yeah, we did shoot a lot in Romania. We did shoot some stuff in Bulgaria, but we're actually in these cities and we're doing stuff with them. And I think that's what lends the air of authenticity. That's why I say there'll never be anything like this because we're insane.
That's why they're applauding right now.
Yeah.
They're applauding.
We'll go out and we'll do stuff that no one thinks is possible. And that's what I think I pride myself on. Is I've had a great cast, crew, companies, Asylum and Sci-Fi that just enabled it. They're enablers. For better or for worse, they enabled us to do crazy stuff and the fans followed us. And when you keep saying, should there be another one? Look, it's satisfying knowing that it can end without having... And I always say this, no disrespect to Jonathan Lipnicki. You're on the 10th film, and then Jonathan Lipnicki comes in to play Finn. And then you're wrapping it up. It's like, man, it's been great 10 movies. It wouldn't feel right.
Right.
It's so hard with the schedules of the actors on these movies that there's always that risk that, you know, they might not can be in the film. So to be able just to end it, and then whatever happens afterwards, we don't have to worry about it. We've done it. Mm-hmm. We finished it, so there's a catharsis. And, you know, I think it's time for, it's like a TV show. It's done. When it's time to do something else, it'll happen.
Well, don't you, I mean, you got to do what Lost didn't get to do, which was have a good ending.
But we were so fully aware, like there's several, everybody kept thinking we're going to have a jaded ending or another cliffhanger. And Robbie says too, we're fans of classic TV endings. I mean, if anything, correlation, you could say Cheers or whatever. It's just, we wanted it to be a wrap up. There was moments where even the network was saying, yeah, you should cut a little bit more out of the bar scene. Like, no. If people have tuned out at that point, then they're not fans of the franchise. We earned that bar scene.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I wanted that speech at the end. It's written to everybody. It's saying goodbye. It's Al Roker. It's saying goodbye. It's seeing all your friends back. It's seeing John Hurd, knowing everything's going to be okay.
Yeah.
It's just, the thing is, we just wanted to say, look, sunny skies, everything's going to be okay. Go out. We're over. It's done. But we love you as much as you love us, but it's now time to say goodbye. And the end title song, which Robbie did a great job on, it's like, you know, love is stronger than goodbye. It's like, you know, we love these movies. It's over.
Wow.
But you have six films. You have a complete two trilogies in a box set, and you can go back and enjoy them for whatever they are with a consistent director from beginning to end.
And that, you know what? George Lucas didn't get to do that.
No.
George Lucas only directed four of the Star Wars films.
And not consecutively.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
And you know, Michael Bay did five Transformers. Blake Edwards did, I don't know how many Pink Panthers, but he didn't do Inspector Clouseau, which, according to everything I've looked up, because I want to have some record, you know, Inspector Clouseau is canon because it's the same producer, same writer. He couldn't come back to do it because he was doing something else. So it's canon, even though he did the rest of the Pink Panther. So on a technicality, yeah. I'm sorry, Blake, but I beat you.
Well, so now that it's over, is there a final word, a final Easter egg, a thing that you want to leave the audience listening to this podcast, people listening to the podcast, is something you want to let them know that you've never said in any previous interview? You've done countless interviews now. Well, you haven't done countless interviews. I don't think I don't consider you to be overexposed in that sense. You know, I'm just happy we got to have this long of a conversation. Because yeah. Every time I've seen you, which is every year at Comic-Con for the most part,
yeah.
or some nerdy event, it's always like, hey, you're doing this thing? Yeah, yeah. So just doing this podcast has been a joy for me just to be able to have an in-depth conversation about the movies because I love them so much. It is like that. Like, I remember when the second one, it was just like, okay, it's in the DVR and I'm just going to make sure it's in the other DVR just in case.
Look,
But is there something, a secret you want to share with us?
There's no secrets about it. But the thing that I'm appreciative of is that it's given me, like, I was known as a horror guy, and now I'm the Sharknado guy. But within that, I've gotten opportunities to do things I would never have gotten to do without Sharknado. I got to do commercials, did a hip hop dance commercial because I love music. I did a thriller a couple years ago.
You've been mentioned on Howard Stern.
I've been mentioned on Howard Stern. I like in May. It's been crazy what it's done, and it's like, I, you know, when I'm gone, it's gonna be the Sharknado guy, and I'm okay with that. But
that'll be on your gravestone.
Yeah, but it's opened a lot of doors, and it's let people see me in a different light. And I go into a meeting, and is whatever anybody thinks of it, it's like, it's not, oh, what did you do? Boo. What is that? Is that the Medea? No, it's a thriller. It's like Sharknado. Everybody knows what Sharknado is, no matter what they think it is or not what it is. It's just,
even if they haven't seen it, they're aware.
It's a good conversation starter. And I made a lot of money for a lot of people on this thing, the network and Asylum. I mean,
everyone probably, but yourself. I'm going to get,
I've done okay on these movies.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, we've done pretty good. I mean, considering, you know, it's been a step up from the stuff I've done in the past.
Right.
But it's all the ancillary stuff that's been good. So look,
there's Sharknado slot machines in Vegas.
And they use our song in there too.
Yeah, no, it's great. So it's got to be some license fee for that.
Yeah, like, no, yeah. So you know, it's nice to know that, look, I just want to keep directing, and I now have the ability to continue to do it. And because of the success of that, and even my other films did incredibly well. Boo exceeded expectations, being a low budget horror film.
Mm-hmm.
We shipped 100,000 units when no one was shipping things. We sold every single foreign territory over the course of 8 years. It aired on Sci-Fi, did better ratings than Battlestar Galactica. I mean, that movie was successful. That got me hooked up with Sci-Fi, and that started things off. So, you know, I have a good track record, and I've been able to do things that are my own things and not sequels to other people's things. So, you know, I'm thankful. I'm grateful because, as you know, it's hard making a living as a filmmaker. It's hard making a living as a journalist.
Yeah.
And I have a franchise, and I'm proud of it, and I'll never look back on it. I will never say, oh, that thing. I know the stuff's fleeting. So you enjoy it, and you continue to get better at what you do. I'm such a better filmmaker from when I started, for now, from, you know, what I've learned over six movies. I could have never done six if I hadn't done one. When I did my Lifetime movie, The Thriller, it was, I kept thinking, oh my gosh, we're not doing enough. But because of all the lessons I learned, I mean, it's bigger than most of those movies because we knew how to make it work. Yeah, I mean, that's kind of thing is, hopefully, you know, Hollywood will come around to and go, hey, you know, he did this for $2 million. Let's give him 20 or 30 and see what he can come up with.
But isn't that where, to me, is some of the best directors come from? They're cut from that cloth.
Yeah.
They made trauma movies, and then suddenly they're doing Guardians of the Galaxy.
Raimi's doing, Spider-Man. And
right.
You know, yeah.
They all came from...
Lord of the Rings, Peter Jackson did Bad... Go back and look at Bad Taste and Meet the Feebles, and you think that's the guy that would be doing Lord of the Rings?
Exactly. But I think that's where... To me, the better filmmakers come is from that indie spirit of, we have nothing. We have to make the movie through sheer force of will. Just get it made, get it on screen, and you know, then when you have money, it's only going to be better.
I'll say this. Look, here's the thing. Warren Zevon, big fan of, singer, songwriter. He used to sub for Paul Schaefer on David Letterman, and he was dying of cancer. And he did his final album, you know, while he was dying, and it's a beautiful album. And Letterman had him on and spent the whole episode with him. And he performed, which was probably pretty much was the last time he performed publicly. And you're talking to a dying man, and literally, and Letterman goes, knowing what you're going through and everything, you know, what do you take away from this? What have you learned? And Warren Zevon, in Warren Zevon's brilliant way, he said, I learned to enjoy every sandwich. And I'm enjoying every sandwich. And whatever comes after this, I'll continue to enjoy it, because I've seen everything from the journalism side. I've seen people who have succeeded and seen people who have failed. I've seen people whose egos got out of control. I've watched TV shows derailed by actors that thought they were going to become movie stars and stuff like that. It's like, I have no pretenses. I'm proud of what I did. You can hate the movies, you can love the movies, but you're talking about them. And at the end of the day, every time we made these movies, and as what a black hole, not being around my family for 6 months trying to deliver them, I enjoyed every sandwich. I had a meal, and you know, hopefully there's many, many more meals to come.
Well, hopefully not a shark fin sandwich, because I think that would be illegal.
Yeah, I won't do that.
Thank you, Anthony, for doing the show.
Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it.
Something's not right.
Get out, enjoy some time with the family on this beautiful day. There won't be anything quite like it again.
Shark! Look out!
If we stop the first shark now, we can stop them all.
Time travel's risky. If we do it right, we can reset everything back to the way it should be.
Welcome to prehistoric times.
Finn! I know this is extremely confusing, but we're all very much alive.
Look out!
Where are we?
Welcome to Merlin's castle.
There's a Sharknado coming.
Dragon sharks?
Good luck with that. Bye!
Yeehaw!
The vortex is collapsing.
Come on, let's go.
The sharks are coming! The sharks are coming!
Let's go kill some sharks.
Come on!
The British are throwing flying sharks at us.
Go! Ah!
The hell was that?
Maybe that's how sharks evolved over the last 20,000 years. Can't wait to see what the humans look like.
Planet of the Apes.